Despite the restaurant industry being one of the hardest hit with establishments closing left and right, there are those who have chosen to play by their own rules and still come up with products from the comforts of their own homes. Such is the case with Mikey Del Rosario. He was once a director for ABS-CBN shows such as Ipaglaban Mo and Be Careful With My Heart. He's now a chef who has mastered the art of making paella, offering a sumptuous specialty to those who miss dining out and crave the authentic Spanish dish. I caught up with Direct Mikey to talk shop, and here's what he had to say. Well, let's start first, because I know that you do that now. You are a chef now. But before all of that, you were actually, your day job was being a director. A director for commercials, a director for shows. Talk to us about how you got into that. Was that something that you always knew you were going to do?
Yeah, that's always been a thing for me. It started out when I was a kid. I had to do a couple of AVPs for my family, and that got the ball rolling, and I enjoyed the whole process. So one thing led to another, and I went to film school in New York. Ever since that, I haven't stopped working since then. I mean, I'm still directing now a little bit.
What was your first directorial gig?
Oh, I mean, the directing thing came, it's a process. You can't immediately jump in and become a director. So what happened was I had to start first as a production assistant, and then you start assisting people, and then a production designer. And then one thing will eventually, hopefully, lead you to a path to directing your own stuff. The first things I've done were commercials for brands, and then I branched out into TV and travel shows, which I'm sure you know also. Asian Air Safari, and teleseries, and ultimately other things, music videos and such.
How long was that process for you from being a PA, which all of us have had to do at one point or another?
Because sure.
I'm sure that in our industry, that is sort of the process, right? You're entrenched in the community, and then, you know, you sort of prove yourself little by little. So how long was it for you from PA to your first directorial gig, if you even remember that?
Oh, well, actually, funnily enough, I was already offered a directorial gig even before I came home from film school, but I had to turn that down because I felt like I didn't know much about the scene as I've been in New York, no? So I had to turn down a couple of directorial gigs because I just felt like I needed to know the whole process first before I started directing my own stuff, which is a big responsibility. So it took like maybe, I took maybe about under a year to just learn the ropes of production in general.
Exactly. Then you said that you also, well, ANC has Asian Air Safari as well. We've had Cap Joy for many, many seasons, and we actually worked together on Asian Air Safari for a few of those seasons.
Yeah, yeah.
But you also did a lot of ABS shows, and you also, of course, do a lot of TVCs. And your stint in ABS was until around 2016. What happened to you after that? Where did you go?
Yeah, well, after that, I went to, I got an offer to become a creative director for a hotel chain. And I do all of their online ads, and I do all of their collaterals for billboards, etc. I write all the copy and stuff. So that's what I've been doing after ABS, which was a full-time thing for about 4 or 5 years. It really occupied my time a lot. But in between that, that's when I kind of also had a lot of time to develop some culinary skills. I tried to develop that in between everything.
But when did you do that, in the sense that you told yourself, you know what, this is also something I'd like to sort of, you know, do?
Be a chef. Yeah.
Because you always liked cooking. I'm sure you cooked with your mom. You cooked with, you know, I mean, you love cooking for your daughter as well. But it's very different to be a home chef or a home cook.
Right.
And to proceed into a full-blown business.
Well, actually, my family has been into the restaurant business for a long time. I've been in the restaurant business for a long time, but never actually cooking. I was managing the restaurants At the time, I was in the front of the house, making sure people were served properly and the service was good. But also while doing that, I managed to talk to a couple of our chefs that used to work with us. The late great Ed Kimson took me under his wing a little bit and taught me a few things and made me actually love food the way he did. And ever since then, there was no turning back. I always really loved eating and eventually cooking.
And Chef Ed was really known as well for his Spanish cuisine. Is this why you were leaning towards that? I mean, we'll get into your other businesses after that, because I know that you do other cuisines as well, but Spanish seems to be something that's very close to your heart.
Oh yeah, Chef Ed was always known for his Spanish cuisine. He was actually Spanish. And I'm also Spanish, if you don't know. I actually have a citizenship to Spain. And I go there all the time. We have a place in Spain where, and that's where I kind of do a lot of research, and I do a lot of R&D based on just like talking to people and to friends and making sure I get the techniques right, because I wouldn't want to, you know, mess it up.
But when did you start selling your stuff? Did you? I know that you did it from home first, and then you had a place called Mabini.
Right. No, Mabini's was before the whole pandemic. That was something that we wanted to come up with the Thesaurus Group. Thesaurus Group has always been championing the Filipino spirit and the Filipino artists. And the next logical step for them was, of course, to champion Philippine cuisine. No, so they approached me, and then they were like, "We would like to put up a restaurant. Can you help us?" And from there, I made the menu together with Chef Pete Ason, and we had a really great time making that menu.
And how is Mabini doing now? Because, you know, you did mention the pandemic. We've been 7 minutes in, and you know, this is one of the interviews where the pandemic hasn't come in until this time.
Right. You
know? Because, I mean, sometimes it's also nice to reminisce about how life was before that. So Talk to us about how your year began, 2020, because obviously the pandemic was just starting in Wuhan. You know, it wasn't even called a pandemic yet. What were your plans for this year?
Wow, we had major plans for Mabini's. At that point, when the year started, we had already two branches. Well, almost three, actually. We were supposed to open in a mall. We had three branches. We had an express in a mall. We had a full-blown restaurant, and we had a cafe. And there were more plans to expand. Unfortunately, the pandemic hit. And as it is, you know, back then, if around March, it was almost like a slow denial where we were like, okay, so let's see if we can kind of ride this out a little bit. We'll close for 2 weeks. And then the 2 weeks became a month, and then a month became 2 months. And after a while, we were just like, well, maybe it's just not feasible for us to actually keep counting. And maybe we should kind of like cut our losses, so to speak. But I mean, right now we're on hiatus. It's not that we're closed. We do, the Thesaurus family and the Thesaurus Group owns the building where we're at. So the current plans are, once the pandemic has kind of gotten under control, that we would be in talks again to resume the restaurant.
Well, I'm assuming that that's a safe haven for you, just because the rental is a big issue or topic with a lot of restaurants that, you know, haven't seen business in several months. And, mm-hmm. you know, with the economy starting up again, they were asked for rentals, and I don't think they could keep up, probably. So this
is we're one of the lucky ones. We're one of the lucky ones for sure, that we actually do own the property that we're at. But of course, I mean, some other branches that we have, such as the Glorieta one, we had to really close that down because, as you know, nobody really goes to the malls nowadays. And we have a restaurant also in Intramuros, and that's also been heavily hit because of the pandemic with tourism and everything.
Exactly. But you're a guy with many hats, right? So the pandemic didn't just attack your restaurateur hat. It also attacked your director hat, because a lot of productions halted. I mean, I know some are starting up again, but how did it affect you when everything closed down?
That was a double whammy for me. It was, I'm not going to lie, it was very, very hard. You know, it. I took it quite, you know, I took it in stride, but of course I was very worried and sad, of course, that all of these things, my mode of income has pretty much stopped in all aspects, right? But that's also where survival kind of kicks in. I allowed myself to be kind of sad for a week or two. And then I realized I can't sustain that. Diba, Lex? It's very hard for you to kind of just be in a funk for that long. And then survival instincts start to kick in. And that's when I said, I'm gonna need to try and figure out what I can do, what I'm good at, and see how I can turn this around. And that's where this whole home business cooking thing came in.
You also were doing so many good things with, you had also you were taking care of TVCs for a major fast food chain, and you had the accounts of, because this fast food chain also exists in Canada and everywhere else, and you were handling that. So that was a big chunk of your paycheck as well.
That was, yeah. I mean, as you know, the biggest hit industry is the airline industry as well. And unfortunately, that account needed for me to travel to North America to do my work. And as soon as the pandemic hit, all air travel stopped. So that one stopped for me as well.
I'm glad that you shifted right away. So talk to us about what you're doing, what your particular pivot was for this pandemic.
Well, yeah. As you know, like I went to Spain for a while. I studied there. I learned a lot of things. And one of those major things was actually how to make an authentic, honest to goodness Spanish paella. So back in during those times when we would travel to Spain, we managed to procure one big paella stove, which is actually what you need to make a really good paella. You need a big stove, because as you know, the paella pans are kind of huge, you know? And you can't cook that over a small fire. So we bought one of those. I had one of those. I had a few paella pans that I had that I got from Spain as well. So I figured, I think that would be a good idea for me to make paellas, because back during that time that I started at Lex, everyone kind of has gotten into the whole cooking from home and selling it from home, online selling of food. So I needed to find a way to be able to differentiate myself and say, I need to be able to provide something that isn't readily available elsewhere and that is very hard to cook in your own home. Because, I mean, a lot of people make of course, you know, the ube pandesals and the kimchis and all of those things. But those things, actually, you can kind of make at home or with just a little bit of equipment and know-how. So the true key to actually succeeding in online sales, selling of food, is to find your niche. Find something that nobody really wants to do at home or would have a hard time doing or nobody has the patience to do.
Exactly. I mean, that was going to be my next question. You hit the nail on the head, finding your edge, because there are so many, you know, it's chock-a-block of different things that they're offering. And I see in your Instagram account that you're also into the whole sourdough. I mean, you know, because the inner chef in people has arisen, right, during the pandemic. And how do you separate yourself? I mean, apart from, I don't know if there are other people offering paella as well. I know that some restaurants, from the actual restaurant, are offering paella. You can pick it up or take it away or even eat it there with social distancing rules in place. But with yours, it's a full authentic paella cooked in the comforts of your own home. Is this the specialty that you offer?
Of course, yeah. Again, like I said, it's the one thing that I can cook that not a lot of people know how to cook, or not a lot of people really want to cook. You need specialized equipment for it. I have a couple of friends, Spanish friends, who also do paellas as well. And no doubt, theirs are also very good. But again, I had to find my niche, which is why I decided that I live in the South, Lexi. I live in the deep South, not even the Alabang side, Laguna side. So I decided to kind of like first start with my neighborhood and then slowly corner the whole South market, so to speak.
And how's it been going for you so far? I mean, I know that you also have things like Kalios and all of this on offer, but have you had customer feedback? Have you had loyal customers come back every so often to get, because paella, I mean, I love paella, but it's a heavy dish. I mean, I don't think I can have it every day, maybe once a week. So I'm sure the customers come back every so often to, you know, to restock.
For sure. It's the paella I find is actually a weekend dish. A lot of people order it for their small family gatherings because, as you know, you can't have big family gatherings yet at this point in time with the GCQ rules. So my paellas are actually good for about up to 10 people, which is just the maximum amount of people that you're allowed to have lunch or dinner with in your own home. And I mean, so that's a weekend thing, but I also realized that I needed to do something that was available not for the weekends, which is why I came up with my Kalios and all of these other Filipino Spanish dishes that I came up with. And the response has been great, Lex. It's, I've had people order multiple times in a week. I guess people are kind of sick and tired of cooking at home as well. And I offer a service where they don't have to do that.
And do you do different kinds of paella? I mean, because there's the Valenciana, there's the paella negra, which is a personal favorite. Do you offer different kinds? Or sometimes is it easier to offer one kind so they know what they'll be getting every single time?
Well, I do have to offer many different kinds, although I was trained to do the paella Valenciana, which is actually the mother of all paellas. And people from Valencia will actually be very upset to know that I actually I do other kinds of paellas as well. They're very protective of their recipe. They're very protective of the name. But for them, the only paella is a paella Valenciana, which is actually chicken or rabbit meat. But of course, I use only chicken. But the Philippines is the Philippines. We're a rice-eating country. I have to be able to give people options. So I do have seafood paellas, and I do have negras and all of these things, which I have to do to be able to sustain, because I can't just cook one dish and leave people with no options.
Exactly. So this home cooking business, is it getting you by, or are you starting to direct again? Because I know that some productions have pretty much started because the economy's opened up, and, you know, I mean, life has gone on in a new sort of normal with a lot of restrictions, of course, and protocols in place. But have you already started directing again, or are you going to keep that in the back burner for now?
Well, I have gotten a few offers to do some directing locally, stuff that I haven't actually done abroad because I can't go abroad yet. But truth be told, Lexi, I'm actually still a little bit scared a little bit to go out into the public and to be interacting with all of these people. The virus is still very much a real threat, and I don't really want to expose myself too much to too many people at the moment. So I'm keeping that in the back burner for now. Hopefully this pandemic will end sometime soon and we can get back to that.
Would you say that you're taking the pandemic and everything that comes with it a day at a time? Or are you silently making plans for the new normal or the future that is hopefully in the horizon that we can see?
I have a plan for the future, of course, but in a way, you still have to take it a day at a time because you never know. It's so uncertain right now. Everything's pretty much up in the air in terms of like the COVID response and what we're going to do.
Well, in terms of your two babies, you have the directing and you have your you know, your chef hat on as well. Do you see yourself progressing in one direction more, with another one being maybe a sideline project, or are you still going to focus on both eventually? Because both industries have really been hit hard. And I'm wondering if you feel personally that one industry will bounce back quicker than the other.
Wow, that's a tough one. Everyone needs food. Everyone needs to eat. It's a basic necessity. It's sustenance. So I feel like the food industry will bounce back just a little bit quicker than the production side, especially with this whole fiasco with, you know, the some government officials with what happened to ABS-CBN. Things have really gone topsy-turvy in terms of the production end. And it's not just ABS-CBN that's been hit, but it's basically, it dominoed into everything else with TVC production and all of these things. So as for now, I think it would be the food industry, the restaurant business, I think has a little bit of a better chance to bounce back quicker, just because people need to eat.
Exactly. Well, final message about, you're such a positive guy. You always have been. You know, you allowed yourself to grieve a little bit, and now you're back on track. What would you say to those out there who are still finding their own pivot? Because it's not the easiest thing to just, you know, come up with a business from the comforts of your home. I mean, you have to be a pretty creative man or woman to be able to, you know, and a very strong one to be able to say, you know what, this is what I can do, and make it a success in a matter of weeks.
You just have to figure out a way to find your strengths and bet on yourself, because no one else will bet on you. You have to find that edge that you have, and that killer instinct that you have, and each one of us have, all of us have that, and we just have to kind of find a way to kind of harness that into something creative, other than wallowing in self-pity, which we're also, I mean, it's healthy, and you have to do it, you have to mourn, but don't mourn for too long, and you just have to kind of like take the horse by the reins, you know.
Exactly. So where can people try your wonderful paella? And I know that you also are taking care of a tiny restaurant in Tagaytay currently.
Right. Well, you can find me there more often than not in Tea House Restaurant, Tea House Hotel in Tagaytay. It's a small, quaint bed and breakfast. And they recently also just reopened after the whole Taal volcano eruption and the whole pandemic. So they used that time to be able to revamp the menu and the amenities. And now it's brand spanking new. And it's the menu is brand spanking new. And it's 100% my menu. So if you want to try my cooking, definitely. And if you find yourself in Tagaytay, go to Tea House in Tagaytay.
All right, Mikey Del Rosario, chef, and of course, director still. I'll always see you as Direct Mikey. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. Stay safe and continue the good work you do.
My pleasure, Lex. Thank you for having me.